I'm really, really thrilled to be here today. It's actually a great honour for me, and I'd really welcome people to come and talk to me about their work, me talk to you about your work. Please just email me when I'm here, and it'd be great to meet up. But of course, in particular, I just want to thank Cathy Coburn for basically being the person who instigated all of this and has helped all the time in getting it underway. And of course, the Vice Chancellor, Professor Karen Millen, really grateful that that you could come. But also, I want to also thank Denise Churchill, who's been just amazing in making sure that everything runs smoothly. Mm-hmm. So very, very grateful to her. But what I want to talk to you about today is not a really pleasant topic. Most of my things aren't very pleasant, but it's about sexual violence and medicine. Basically, at 10 o'clock, or just after 10 o'clock on Saturday, the 22nd of January, 1977, 2.5 million people in the UK turned on BBC Two to watch a 90-minute double-feature programme about rape. The film consists of two interlacing parts. On one hand, there was a television play called Act of Rape, which was actually written by Faye Weldon, and there was a panel discussion chaired by Jackie Gillott, who's one of the first female presenters in Britain. Now, Weldon's play was based on actual court cases of the 1970s, and it's about this young woman who complains to the police about having been raped, and the whole question is, well, is she lying or not? Crucial in the play is her examination by a police surgeon, who in the play, it's very, very dramatic, we can hear her behind the doors crying out, screaming in great pain as she is medically examined. The jurors then, in the play, the jurors then are told by the judge that women do tell false tales for reasons good, bad, or indifferent, and that it's dangerous to convict without corroboration. Now, at various places in this play, the play is actually interrupted, the television play is interrupted, and the cameras turn to the studio discussion. Two of the men on this panel, this one here, two of the men on this panel are Judge Christmas Humphrey and Police Surgeon David Paul. And they are remarkably relaxed, to put it mildly, about the pain that women might feel during and in the immediate aftermath of rape. Judge Humphrey argued that, quote, the condition of the girl's vulva is the most powerful corroboration, showing that something much more than forceful play had taken place. And I actually believe, and I hope I'm right here, that that's the first time the word vulva was used on British television. Humphreys, however, was in fact very well known at the time. He was very well known because he had passed just a few weeks earlier, a 6-month suspended jail sentence for on a man convicted of raping two women with a knife. Shortly after that decision, he sentenced a man to 18 months in prison for fraud involving £2,000. The police doctor on the panel also had a very problematic record. In the same year as the programme, he published an article in which he argued that, quote, penile penetration into the vagina of a small child cannot be accomplished without considerable force. But then he went on to discuss only injury to the penis of the assailant. Their responses, however, were in fact really typical of the 1970s. There's a series of judges who were interviewed in 1971 who routinely called rape things like friendly rape, felonious gallantry, and assault with failure to please. And this was in formal interviews. However, the program caused this massive outcry amongst one group of people in particular, and that is amongst police surgeons, also known as police doctors and later forensic medical examiners, FMEs, who believed that they had been unjustly maligned. They were furious about that portrayal of the medical examination. However, the critique of police surgeons enacted in Act of Rape was becoming extremely common from the late 1960s. Second wave feminists were becoming increasingly concerned about the incredible power wielded by police surgeons in cases involving sexual assault. Medical reports were often decisive in determining whether or not the police took the assault seriously, if legal proceedings were to be instigated, and of course the final decision in any subsequent court appearance. The treatment of complainants by police surgeons had profound effects on the victims as well, including their physical health, you know, what was done about injuries, sexual transmitted diseases, the possibility of pregnancy, etc., their psychological well-being, feelings of guilt, anxiety, depression, and of course life outcomes, the risk of sexual or social dysfunction, drug and alcohol abuse, self-harm, and suicide. However, these doctors remained very resistant to change. But first, who are we talking about? Who are these police surgeons, these police doctors? Well, England, Wales, the term police surgeon it was first formalised in 1829 with the passing of the Metropolitan Police Act. Any person with a medical degree could apply for the role. They had the three most important responsibilities were inspecting prisoners, medically inspecting prisoners, 21% of their time, testing drivers for alcohol, 29% of their time, and medically examining complainants of sexual assault, which took up 18% of their time. And it's this latter responsibility that got them into hot water in the 1970s. But of course, not for the first time. Police surgeons had a long history indeed of uneasy, to put it mildly, uneasy relationships with women's organisations. However, the last time they were exposed to such public scrutiny was exactly a century earlier to the case that we've been looking at, I mentioned at the beginning of this talk, where it involved their role in examining women under the Contagious Diseases Acts of the 1860s. Under these acts, women living in certain port towns and army towns could be detained on suspicion of being prostitutes and then subjected to compulsory medical checks for venereal disease. In what was often extremely graphic languages, especially of course for the 1860s, the police surgeons who carried out these medical examinations were accused of symbolically raping the women brought before them with the violent speculum. 100 years later, in the 1970s and 1980s, tensions between police surgeons and feminist activists also coalesced, if you like, around anxieties about sexual violence. The uproar in 1977 over Weldon's play and then the panel discussion was not an isolated incident, so we can talk about the vast number of scandals in this period at another time. Increasingly, in other words, feminist voices could be heard accusing police surgeons of being in league with the police, of promoting a rape culture, and discouraging victims of rape from reporting their ordeal. These feminists provided evidence, copious evidence, showing that the prospect of a humiliating and sometimes painful medical examination was one of the most important things in deterring women from reporting attacks. Anti-right rape activists published lengthy accounts of unsympathetic and even brutal medical responses. Some of this, a lot of it in fact, most of it, was anecdotal, but there also were very, very systematic surveys taking place. The most influential probably was Jerry Chambers and Anne Miller's study of 1983, in which 42% of rape complainants made negative comments about their experience with the police surgeons, and an additional 18% made both negative and positive views, same people. Typical complaints included the painful nature of the examination, the amount of time victims had to wait before being seen, inappropriate examination facilities, the unavailability of a doctor, female doctor, and the lack of privacy, including male CIDs actually sitting behind a screen during the examination, as indeed was shown in Weldon's television play. Women described how their clothes were taken away, but they were not given alternative garments. Victims were upset about the collection of samples and that the tests taken took precedent over looking after their injuries, even if they were very severe injuries. They resented being questioned about whether they had resisted sufficiently. One complainant was even asked if she enjoyed it. "It was as if I was on the slab of a morgue," said another. Okay, so what explanation can we give for this perceived lack of sensitivity to rape victims? First, I think, as we heard with Judge Humphreys, physical injury was assumed to stand in for real rape. So physical injury was the gold standard, if you like, for real rape. And the problems with this, of course, are very obvious. Only a small proportion, 5 to 30% of rape victims, can ever point to any lesion. Victims often report early, and so their bruises or lesions have healed. Victims often submit out of terror, or because there's a weapon involved. There's no clear relationship between the extent of tissue damage and the degree of pain or hurt experienced, and a significant proportion of consensual sexual activity in fact creates lesions and bruising. Second, in this period, the job of the police surgeon was a highly masculine one. 1985, the ratio of female to male police surgeons was 1 to 7.5. Third, the post actually attracted a certain type of doctor, specifically those who are willing to accept lower pay and poor working conditions. You know, remember, these time-consuming examinations are usually taking place late at night. If the case goes to trial, it can drag on for weeks, months, even years, requiring physicians to spend valuable time in court, where defense attorneys routinely questioned their abilities, their authority. The job attracted physicians with Navy and Army service, as well as those willing to have regular contact with people that they considered to be the dregs of society: criminals, drunks, prostitutes, degenerates, and other unsavory characters. Furthermore, of all their roles, police surgeons found examining victims of sexual violence particularly repugnant, in their words. Rape complainants often arrived in a disarranged state. They were typically distraught, barely able to make consistent statements. After conducting the medical examination, police surgeons, of course, rarely saw these victims again. They almost never became part of their regular medical practice. In other words, these people they were seeing are not the usual patients that most doctors in private practice would have been accustomed to dealing with. Crucially, rather than being accountable to the victims and his or her family and friends, police surgeons were enmeshed in police culture. So, for example, a very influential 1984 survey showed that over half of police surgeons believed that it was always their duty to offer an opinion to the police or prosecuting authorities prior to the trial about the legitimacy of the rape complaint. And another 40% believe they should usually give an opinion. So 90% believe that that was part of their job, basically. One half believe that they should ask complainants about their previous sexual experience, even though this had been deemed irrelevant by the Helbron report of 1975. When asked to elaborate on their duties, only 45% of those surveyed said they, and by the way, 80% of all police surgeons were surveyed here, only 45% of those surveyed said that they should provide services to women who feared they were pregnant, and only 36% prescribed medicine against sexually transmitted infections. Now, the law enforcement environment in which these police surgeons worked was also not conducive to therapy, most medical examinations in this period took place within police stations. Or, as the president of the Association of Police Surgeons admitted, 1985, they took place in the immediate vicinity of numerous noisy, undesirable, and unsavory characters. In other words, these examinations are taking place next door to the cells. The situation was exacerbated by the fact that police surgeons were not trained in forensic or legal medicine. In 1985, only 9% of police surgeons had taken any classes in medical jurisprudence. 20% had no training even in gynecology or obstetrics. Police surgeons also belonged to a profession that was acutely sensitive to accusations, to false accusations, to issues of false accusations. Unlike other professions, medical professionals were regularly required to have contact with the sexual organs of strangers. From their first year in medical school, they had been schooled in the risk of false accusations of sexual assault, and they understood the need to always have a chaperone around when conducting intimate examinations. As a consequence, disbelief in rape complainants was deeply entrenched. Mm-hmm. So 1977, survey of police surgeons found that nearly one-third of rape complainants were believed to be false. Even female, the very few, female police surgeons thought that one-quarter of women who turned up at the police station were lying. In the words of very prominent, very influential police surgeon, Abraham David Matthews, who did a lot of a training of police surgeons, and he was one himself, there were, his words, many frustrated neurotics who are quite capable and indeed anxious to cause trouble for a perfectly innocent and respectable man who has been unfortunate enough to come into contact with them. In the words of another police surgeon at the same time, rape complainants go into the sexual episode with their eyes and legs wide open. And this was not an idiosyncratic opinion of two, albeit very influential, police surgeons. It's actually very, very widespread in the period. Indeed, heightened skepticism of rape complainants was enshrined in the very heart of law and medicine. With the cautionary instruction most famously introduced by Lord Chief Justice Matthew Hale as long ago as the 17th century, still being read out. It was also explicitly taught to physicians in textbooks of medical jurisprudence, and this persisted well into the late 20th century. As in the manual for police surgeons called The Practical Police Surgeon, it's the manual published by the Association for Police Surgeons, said women always lie. Even Inspector Sandra Hood, as she informed a annual meeting of police surgeons in 1984, by the way, her job is to train officers into aspects of sexual abuse, as she told the annual meeting, the female of the species is a devious creature. Institutional distrust meant that the entirety of a complainant's life and comportment had to be meticulously scrutinized. I've already mentioned this, but in 1975, the Halborn Committee had concluded that the private sexual history of a complainant was irrelevant to the facts of a case. However, despite this, throughout the 70s and 80s, the Association of Police Surgeons of Great Britain continued to insist that a woman's history of sexual liaisons was crucial to assessing their veracity. Key indicators for these people were virginity and decor. As late as 1996, the president of the Section of Forensic Medicine at the Royal Society of Medicine even joked that the seductresses in Sully's book, Carnal Knowledge, Rape on Trial, must have, quote, had their lustful appetites enhanced by alcohol. And the seductress he's talking about here are, of course, victims of women reporting rape. But the crucial question facing these police surgeons was, well, how could you actually know whether a woman or child had really been sexually assaulted? corroboration was, of course, required. And without exception, police surgeons prioritized physical injury, bodily injury. In the word of their textbook, The Practical Police Surgeon, quote, "The resistance of the female must be total and maintained to the end or until such time as further resistance is impossible." Three problems with the statement. The first is that rape in England, Wales, Ireland and Northern Ireland, although not in Scotland until 2001, was legally defined as without the consent of a person, not against her will. In other words, a victim did not have to sustain wounds. She did not have to fight to the end. She only needed to have refused to consent to sexual intercourse. The second problem was that rape crisis centres in this period, they're just being started, I'll speak about that later if you like, were actually advising women up until the 1990s that it was better to submit, however distasteful this might be, rather than risk serious injury. Third problem was that the two main ways that police surgeons were taught to corroborate sexual abuse, i.e. by reading bodily signs and by evaluating emotional states, were both critically undermined in the 1980s. The first of these, the belief that physicians could generalize from the assessment and measurement of physical marks, was catastrophically damaged during the Cleveland child abuse scandal of 1987, in which medical professionals aggressively and very, very aggressively and very publicly disagreed over the nature of the child's and indeed the adult's sexed body. It was not only revealed that, in fact, physicians had no idea about the genitalia of children, so in fact they couldn't adjudicate on whether or not a physical sign pointed to sexual abuse, but also revealed that they were not even able to tell whether a woman had sexual intercourse, nor did they have any understanding of anatomical variability. The Cleveland scandal, in other words, threw the scientific objectivity of medical professionals, including police surgeons, into crisis mode. Medical critics, however, were caught in a real bind here by seeking to delimit what police surgeons could or could not conclude from the examination of complainants' bodies. They were simultaneously undermining their claim to exclusive and authoritative scientific authority, superior scientific authority. Furthermore, their critiques of clinical assessments of the physiological body reiterated its constructed as opposed to its intrinsic nature. Bodily signs, long considered the gold standard in the clinical corroboration of sexual abuse, were found publicly to be flawed. In response to the lack of forensic consensus, medical examiners were forced to become much more circumspect when reporting findings, particularly in court. In other words, no one wanted to find themselves publicly chastised as the people of Cleveland, the doctors involved in the Cleveland scandal, had been. The second way police surgeons were taught to corroborate sexual abuse was through an assessment of the complainant's comportment. This was also fundamentally undermined in the course of the 1980s. Now, since the beginning of the 19th century, textbooks in medical jurisprudence had provided instruction on how to evaluate the demeanour of a true rape victim. Mid and late 20th century texts followed their predecessors. No lesser authority than the Royal Commission on Criminal Procedure instructed physicians to observe, quote, "Observe the method of undressing. Is the woman a shy, retiring child, or is she a professional stripper? General appearance and demeanor of the victim should be noted, including eccentricity of dress and the use of cosmetics." And that's the Royal Commission's conclusions. Such texts, however, were increasingly mocked and I'm going to turn to this at the end of the talk, undermined by the popularization of notions of psychological trauma. Now, some police surgeons were totally unperturbed by this barrage of criticism about their role. They sought to defend themselves. As one physician complacently observed, much of what seems objectionable in the medical examination of rape victims was done in an atmosphere of stress, often in the middle of the night. In the cold light of day, it may not look so good, but then is it not often so? Still others attacked the critics, particularly the feminist staff at the newly established rape crisis centres, claiming that they were emotional, unreasonable, hysterical. An equally trenchant counterattack included the claim that even female physicians were not suitable examiners of rape victims. The innate emotionalism, that term comes up time and again in these commissions, of all women rendered them unfit for the job. This was a common argument, but I'm just going to give you one example. A lengthy correspondence in the British Medical Journal, 1991. A female, London-based GP, who was often summoned to examine rape victims, admitted in the BMJ that the job was tough. She noted that female examiners needed to have a supportive family life because emotionally it's very difficult. It can take me a couple of days to get over it. You have to be kind and sympathetic, good at writing reports, and good in court. It's a tall order. That comment rebounded very, very dramatically on her and her colleagues. In a response, Robert Moffat, president of the Section of Forensic Medicine at the Royal Society of Medicine, was caustic. He reminded doctors that the job of police surgeons was not for the faint-hearted. It is traumatic and very demanding, requiring high skills. What was needed was cool professionalism. Emotionalism, he wrote, was misplaced and dangerous. Men only need apply. However, the professional body of police surgeons, the Association of Police Surgeons, had to act. At the very least, they recognized the need to reform. If they were to retain their expert status as medical examiners involved in all police needs. They tackled the so-called role conflicts, in other words, the conflict between the medical needs and the policing needs of their paymasters, by attempting to distance themselves from law enforcement agencies. Thus, they renamed themselves forensic medical examiners, not police surgeons. In other words, trying to emphasize the medical as opposed to the policing. And by the way, there's an interesting thing here. It's no coincidence that this whole move, this rebranding, started in Northern Ireland. And you can imagine why that might be. They also embraced new technologies in order to emphasize the scientific nature of their work. There was a concerted attempt to increase the number of female medical surgeons available to examine complainants. And from the 1970s, British rape reformers visited America and Australia, who had begun well in advance of the UK to open sexual assault centres, rape crisis centres, and they imported this knowledge back to the UK, leading to similar initiatives. And we can talk about that, because I'd like to hear more about the Australian side of this story. Finally, police surgeons increasingly, although reluctantly, admitted the existence of rape trauma syndrome and PTSD. This only started to happen from the late 1970s, this admission of rape trauma syndrome and PTSD. In fact, what's startling to note is the absolute absence of discussion about the psychological pain resulting from sexual assault until the late 20th century. Understand this And I think this is really important. To understand this, we need to go back into history. As we all know, psychological trauma entered public discourse in relation to the crisis of railway accidents in the 1860s, 1866, and then, of course, the war of 1914 to 18. In other words, trauma, the Greek word trauma, trauma, moved from its original meaning as a bodily lesion to what we mean today, in other words, an inner emotional response to a bad external event. This only happened, this move from trauma as a bodily injury to a psychological one, the late 1860s, when Freud, by the way, was still a young child. Person John Erik Erikson was the person who did this. But what we have here is we face this really interesting question that despite the rise of psychological trauma as the main way we understand responses to bad events, it was not applied to all bad events. In other words, when we turn to rape, what we find is an example of a obvious bad event to which trauma narratives were excluded until a century, 100 years after the triumph of the psychological. And I don't know if we can talk about this if you like, but basically I've gone through every medical jurisprudence textbook in the British Library and all the journals as well. So Kent state that medical and psychiatric personnel ignore the psychological effects of rape victims until the 1970s. There are two exceptions to this. Mental states linked to sexual assaults did appear in two contexts. First, false accusations. So in other words, forensic and psychiatric textbooks discussed hysteria as a condition that resulted in false accusations rather than being caused by the assault. And the second exception to my argument is frigidity. Particularly 1920s, early sexologists identified fragility as emerging from sexual assault. But they are the only two exceptions. It took until 1970 for the first substantial study of rape trauma to be published. It's not to say that it was ignored altogether. Earlier period, when 19th century and most of the 20th century, when a woman's response to sexual assault was discussed, it was discussed in terms of the victim being rendered insensible. And that's the main term that was used. And this term of insensibility in these earlier rape accounts is important both for victims and their defenders because it actually provided a convincing physical reason why some women failed to fight off their attackers. Ironically, it was the insensible woman, the term used at the time, who was able to actually speak about sexual violence and have her suffering publicly acknowledged. Since a woman who remained sensible, to use again the language of the time, should have been able to resist attack. We can talk about this another time. This only changed slowly beginning in 1970 with this very important article, followed by another article in the American Journal, misspelling there, American Journal of Psychiatry in 1974, which invented rape trauma syndrome. Indeed, from this period, 1970s onwards, in stark contrast to the earlier period where psychological trauma was not seen as relevant, from the 1970s, sexual assault was widely regarded to become exceptionally traumatic, with some feminist therapists going so far as to argue that all women were suffering from post-traumatic stress disorder or insidious trauma. But this became very problematic. Although the originators, these people here, of rape trauma syndrome and the advocates of PTSD for rape survivors intended it to be a therapeutic and educative measure, in other words, to help victims understand what they were going through, to help jurors understand why they didn't report and things like that, it quickly came to play a more negative or ambiguous place in law. As a consequence, the act of diagnosing a psychological trauma increasingly was used by psychiatrists against rape victims. Thus, the rape shield laws, again, introduced in 1975, could be circumvented by appealing to rape trauma syndrome, or PTSD, enabling the entirety of the complainant's life and comportment to yet again be meticulously scrutinized. Rape trials focused on the defendant's conduct, didn't focus on the defendant's conduct so much as the psychological state of the victim. By codifying pain, the languages of psychiatry and psychology appropriated the voices of those experiencing that pain. Finally, with the introduction of rape trauma syndrome, women were increasingly encouraged to think of their pain as private, as opposed to socio-political. Now again, this was not the intentions of those who invented and promoted the term, who saw it as therapeutic to help women. But the 1970s and 1980s, feminists who intervened in debates about rape victims were gradually sidelined, replaced by professional counselors. As feminist theorist Karen Mardossian convincingly, I think, argues, the earlier generation of feminists, 1970s, stressed women's victimization in a context that created and indeed glorified agency, political agency. For that generation of feminists, being a victim of sexual violence meant becoming determined, angry, an agent of change. In contrast, increasingly, the debates became depoliticized and taken up by professional organizations. And indeed, the very term agency became diluted, individualized, depoliticized, and made psychological. Not, in other words, protesting on the streets, but hiring a good counselor or buying a gym membership. Victimization became an internal turmoil rather than an external reality imposed on someone. Rape began to speak to a woman's inner self as opposed to the criminal act. Just to conclude, 1977, first rape crisis center in Britain had only just been established when 2.5 million people in the UK sat down to watch an act of rape. The play confronted the problem of police surgeons and their failures to deal adequately with victims of sexual assault. And in this talk, I've mentioned a number of structural and ideological ways to explain why a profession dedicated to the care of victims of sexual assault might end up violating the oath, first do no harm. Today, 40 years after that broadcast, it would be inconceivable, I think, for our forensic medical examiners to openly sneer at rape victims or to ask them if they enjoyed being assaulted. Rape victims are not likely to be medically examined in dingy rooms next to the cells. Rape trauma, an accepted phenomenon. Nevertheless, problems remain, largely due, I think, to the unfounded assumptions of physicians as rational forensic experts on the body, able to draw precise inferences from its signs. Because clearly, cultures of disbelief have persisted. The assumption of no wound, no assault remains exceptionally strong. Rape trauma syndrome, as I just mentioned, is used more often to discredit victims' statements, as well, by the way, to exonerate alleged perpetrators. The more fundamental problem, however, is that it's really problematic to assume that there has been, in this period I'm talking about, a progression from lack of sympathy to sympathy. After all, complaints about the medical treatment of rape victims continue to be heard. Despite numerous public governmental inquiries, in addition to the composition of formal guidelines about how you're supposed to deal medically with rape victims, major grievances about their actions continue routine. Indeed, and this is the important thing, I think, the same criticisms appear at regular intervals, and each time they do so, very similar and often identical remedies are profited and implemented, only to have the criticism rise up again at a later point. In other words, what we are seeing, I think, is this cycle of harm. Harm, accusation, reform, pause. Harm, accusation, reform. Cycle continues. And I think one thing we really need to think about is why we have this happening. Now, suspicion of the motives of police surgeons is excessively simplistic. Although there are many exceptions, police surgeons are generally concerned about caring for vulnerable people. Equally, it's too cynical to dismiss the public reforms as half-hearted. I think it's lazy to assume that these public inquiries are nothing more than public relations exercises. There's no reason to doubt the sincerity of the people attempting to reform the systems. Rather, to understand cultures of harm within this medical sub-discipline, I think we need to pay more attention to the relationship between bodies and emotions. In the context of sexual violence, the victim's sense of selfhood is appropriated and wounded by the attacker. Given the supreme importance placed on the sexed body, this denial of the self by another person disrupts and may even destroy the connection between the victim's sense of me and my body. Her language may be eradicated altogether, rape, murder, or rendered fragmented, confused, or incoherent. Whether or not she succeeds in adhering to the appropriate script, comporting herself as sensible or insensible in the earlier period, or as self-possessed or traumatized as more recently, her voice is deconstructed through violent social action. And this presents formidable feminological challenges for victims as well as to witnesses to their suffering. The bodies and emotions of rape complainants and police surgeons do not exist in separate worlds. They interact. The physiological body through which police surgeons extract these signs of abuse is not a natural, pre-social entity. It is historically constituted and reconstituted in relationship to other people and language. This is, of course, not to deny the material, its material reality, fluids, tissue, fat, muscle, bone, etc. It is, however, to observe that the wounded body that police surgeons are required to observe and assess is nevertheless accessed through language and responded to emotionally. Bodies are neither private nor individual, but are fundamentally connected to other bodies with whom they communicate. The cycle of harm within a subdiscipline devoted to care is fundamentally about the emotionally fraught nature of bodies in interaction. This is why, if cultures of care are to be fostered, introduced, and sustained, more attention, I suggest, needs to be paid to the interrelationship between the bodies and emotions of the carer and the cared for.
Joanna, fabulous, confronting, excite all of those amazing issues that you're bringing up that have such contemporary relevance. I'm sure there's plenty of questions for Joanna. Wayne, you go.
Thank you. I'm interested in the parallels with domestic violence in the 1970s and 80s. In this country, Commissioner Avery led the charge with the book, Are You a Force or Are You a Service? And most police were surprised to find out that they were expected to be a service. Mm-hmm. Yep. Avery's point was, well, you're part of the welfare state, and all those years ago, the bobbies were about keeping the peace and providing a community service. Now, that debate in the 1970s and 80s, against the backdrop of a lot of disbelieving largely male police, was that no part of policing existed by itself. So if you're in rescue, turning up to domestic violence, surgery, you were expected to look at networks. So the police board was instituted, so there's this broad revolutionary approach, and ironically we went to Bramshill, we went to the UK for the modelling of that. So I guess my question is that why would the surgeons captured by police culture be any different to, even though they're more specialised, than anyone else in the police over that long period of time? And is it therefore the case that in the 1970s and 1980s this broader question of the police as an extension of the welfare state at the time of cutting back of resources, they are left with the bag in offering much more, and to do that they've got a network. So, and my last point is, they're onto university campuses. So we had police here, for example, being trained in justice administration, so that they were reaching out.
Yeah.
You had to get promoted via academic training and networking. A new culture, but it's very, very recent.
Brilliant. Thank you so much, Wayne. I want to hear more maybe later about the Australian connection, because I'm interested in the fact that you're saying it goes in this particular area the other way to what I found in terms of the rape thing. So we'll talk. I'd like to talk to you about that
sure.
later. But you're exactly right about the shift that you're identifying here is taking place very, very much in Britain at the same period.
Mm.
One of the, I think, very, very interesting things that happens is someone called Ian Blair, no relation to the ex-Prime Minister. Ian Blair was a junior rookie, junior cop, a policeman in this period, went to the States and came back with revelations about, oh, we can do it differently in hospitals. We can, and he wrote a book about rape and the police force, which transformed everything, literally everything in Britain, including he was responsible for changing, he was partly one of the main people, responsible for changing the name from police force to police service in Britain. Again, it's happening exactly the same time for the reasons you're giving. Ian Blair then went on to become the Metropolitan Police Chief, the top job in the whole country, and he's on my research, my board for the Wellcome Trust thing. But what's interesting is this importation of knowledges, in his case from America, but who are undergoing problems with the funding of their equivalent of police surgeons, but also the feminists are actually coming to Australia and importing it back to Britain from there.
Mm-hmm.
So it is very much about service versus force, networking, and the cutting of resources.
Mm-hmm.
It's no coincidence at all, and I've written about this elsewhere, that actually the Association of Police Surgeons lose the battle to be the ones responsible for dealing with rape victims, which are then moved to hospitals, general hospitals, A&E wards. Why do they lose that battle? They lose that battle for financial reasons, because what happens is it's cheaper to send them to an A&E ward where nurses are then trained specifically to look after them as opposed to doctors. And it's significantly cheaper to do that. So there's economic reasons for why they're losing that battle. And a later period, we get a real tension when Margaret Thatcher becomes Prime Minister, because she rolls it back even more in ways that were very, very devastating. I mean, closed rape crisis centres in large numbers. But the other thing that Thatcher did was she made individual police departments responsible for their clearance and success rates. And of course what that means is, you know, rape cases are always going to be problematic, more, you know, difficult, they're more expensive, they take up a lot more time. So what that means is that police start trying to convince women not to make a formal complaint, to deal with it informally. So that's the other big shift. So there's two. Lovely, thank you.
Thank you.
But I'd love to hear more about the Australian side.
Linda,
thank you, Joanna. I'm delighted to know that this period of the 70s and 80s is now a subject of historical research at last. And I think from an Australian perspective, I think that there was, by feminists in the 70s and 80s, this a great move to make it a more public issue, that these issues of sexuality belonged to the private realm and were not really to do with the public. And I think feminists and other groups were attempting to make sexuality more politicised, and I think the idea of the term sexual harassment, I think is formally described in 1979, and I think that opened up other opportunities to consider rape and a whole range of other issues in a more public way, and keeping it in the public domain has been the real real struggle, I think.
Yeah, no, I agree totally. I don't think, and I do agree, but I don't think we should forget those earlier movements, the first generation of feminists of the 19th century, particularly over the Contagious Diseases Acts,
yes.
which were they were exceptionally vocal. I mean, even reading their public statements now, and these are, you know, middle class and upper middle class women on public platforms speaking to male as well as female audience, they were extremely graphic. In a way that even reading it today is shockingly graphic. So I don't think we should write off those earlier feminists who tried to do the same thing in that earlier period. And again, Contagious Diseases Acts was a big one because it also involved the police surgeons, was really at the heart of those debates.
The impression it's made on me is, I guess, from an archivist perspective, the key thing here is evidence and how that evidence is gathered. So you've got two forces here. You've got the care of the victim and how that's done, which is what your talk has been concerned with. But I saw the slide up there of the evidence and I thought to myself, well, do these police or police surgeons have any idea of how to gather the evidence that will prove that that actual act, that's at the core of this, is something's happened to this victim and they are in the process of gathering evidence. Now, from what you've displayed here, they didn't seem to have much of an idea. And that backs up, I mean, things that people have told me on here. I mean, even as late as late 90s, early 2000s, I spoke to an archaeologist that was involved in working with police, and she said they had no idea how to deal with a crime scene. You see on TV all the time, they line up in a row, and then they just trample over the entire landscape trying to find the evidence. She said that's about the worst thing you can do. You know, you have to analyse a context of a thing and make sure that you're gathering evidence properly and professionally. And I'm just wondering whether that issue has been sort of brought up. I mean, who decides on how to gather evidence, how it's done? When the living victim, how do you deal with that person as well? Because they're not an object, they're a person.
Yeah.
Necessarily working within
them.
Yeah, so I'm just adding to that.
Yeah, it's they're related. Really, really important because in the period I'm talking about, 1970, they're getting no training whatsoever. I mean, they really are not getting anything. I've gone through all of the training stuff. There is nothing on sexual violence in that. They have no idea. It starts to be introduced in the period that I'm talking about. So I think it's 1972, you get the first forensic lab established. And there again, that's a different story, but what you're finding is these furious battles between the police surgeons who are used to processing the evidence and the forensic scientists who are saying, this, you know, you're making a mess of this.
Yeah.
and that is another battle that I could easily have spoken about here. And the forensic scientists win. Again, it sounds like my guys are not winning anything. The forensic scientists definitely win that battle. But, you know, the introduction of rape kits, for example, that's also happening precisely in this period, mid-70s, slightly earlier in the States. There is an argument, and I'm not sure how far I want to push it, but there is an argument that at least one component of that was the need to outsource the medical examination to nurses away from doctors. So a lot, obviously the big thing is about the collection of evidence, but there is also a lot of argument about, well, actually if we do this, we don't need to pay doctors because we can just train nurses to do this for us, again, in the general hospital. So there's that aspect as well. How important that is relative to the others, I'm not quite sure yet, but it's definitely there.
Yeah. Thank you, that was really interesting. I was interested in the comment that you made a little earlier in the talk when you said about the makeup of the people who actually applied and did this job as police surgeon and that correlation with the military.
Yeah.
Kate knows where I'm coming from. But I'm just thinking with the medical services within the army, for example, they always sort of regarded themselves as in the military but not of it.
Yeah.
And that's sort of similar to this idea I'm seeing with the police. So I'm just wondering if you've actually spoken or as part of your research spoken to the motivations of the guys who actually, or majority who were men, who actually signed up for this job, because like the army, the pay wasn't great, the conditions were often atrocious, and they were caught between that dual responsibility to the patient and the responsibility to the organisation. Mm. So,
I think we have to make a distinction between those at the top levels and the bulk of police surgeons, police doctors, because the bulk of police doctors really are identifying very, very strongly with the police, very, very strongly. And we have very good evidence actually for that, good survey evidence, lots of anecdotal evidence, but we also have really good survey evidence where they explicitly say no, and to the extent that they actually don't treat the wounds until they have, you know, done everything else. And even then, they say, we don't treat the wounds, we'll send them to another doctor to do that. So that is quite conclusive in my view. I think these police doctors, they're very similar to those people working in asylums. They are the work of Louise Hyde and other people, that these institutions of incarceration, stroke care, policing, a lot of them are coming through military and army, navy in this period. So I don't think, in my view, there is some good evidence that similar profile of people who have become police doctors are also be doctors in your big asylums. And I think there's pretty good evidence for that. So that's where they're coming from. And I actually think that they do think they are in, and not that they are in part of the police force. They quite self-identify to that. And it's that top leadership that are beginning to see that this is counterproductive. And they've got to change that. And they try, the Association of Police Surgeons tries to change that against resistance from their own members. So that's why I think there's two levels here, because the top level are very influential, very powerful, you know, men. And I think Northern Ireland is an interesting example of this, because they're framing the changing their names from police surgeon to forensic medical examiners in terms of this role conflict. But in reality, if you look in the archival record and all their correspondence and minutes, it's all about, it's too dangerous to be a police surgeon. You know, we have to identify ourselves, as a doctor. And it starts in Northern Ireland and comes back to Britain. And, you know, that change is resisted by the membership.
Time for one last question. Sorry, I'm sure Joanna would be happy to talk over morning tears on, but I think Vicky.
Thank you. thanks, Joanna. I really like the way you've linked the policing and medicine. It's really powerful, that connection in terms of Aboriginal history and Aboriginal administration. You get medical doctors in charge of policing Aboriginal people because of fears around their being able to contaminate society. But it's just a really basic question, and it's probably got a really simple answer. But when does the system start of a rape victim goes to the police, they have their own doctors that examine? I'm assuming it's a late 19th century thing. Does it sort of come in at the same time as the contagious diseases stuff is getting moved out?
Good question. From 1829, they're police surgeons, and they are called to give evidence in courts from very early period. So I would say it's actually really very early. Yeah, certainly they're giving evidence in court. The very early period, police surgeons are giving evidence, but actually, and I'm wondering when this changes, the other people who give evidence are midwives. So a lot of rape victims are not going to when they go to the police, they are being sent to midwives to do the examination, as opposed to police surgeons who are there. But in court cases, it could be either who is giving evidence. And it'd be interesting to see when it becomes predominantly police surgeons giving evidence and midwives are pushed out.
Or even private doctors.
private doctors.
Yeah. In Australia in the 1920s, where I think there was a police woman who took the girl to a private doctor for examination.
Yeah.
So it was like under the police umbrella, but it was not a police employee.
Yeah, and that certainly happens with middle class and upper middle class rape victims. Yeah, there's a very strong class aspect there.
Yeah.
That's not happening with the vast majority of rape victims. It's police doctors who are giving evidence. But yes, you do see in some high profile cases involving very established families that you get the private doctor, the family doctor
really
coming in.
That's again about that policing there.
And one of the ways that these police doctors try to again protect their field is in the 1980s they try to push out the private doctor from the whole scene because they are not educated, they haven't been trained. So part of the whole move to train police doctors is attempt to exclude your private doctor, your family doctor from the court cases.
Well, I think we should let Joanna have a coffee or a tea or something. So please join me in thanking Joanna again.